our comedian, Mr. Quincy T. Julie. He's going to entertain us. We have my little daughter, Miranda Sandy, who is going to dance for us tonight. And we will have other attractions, but I just want you to sit tight. I want you to relax yourself, feel at ease, and let us marinate for the interest of ALJA, for the interest of press freedom in Liberia, and for the interest of Mama Liberia. Thank you very much.
You know, I came a little late, unfortunately, so I gotta be catching my bites between speakers. I wanna make sure that I fill up the tank before midnight, because nowhere will be open by the time we get out of here. Thank you very much, Mr. Sinem, for your welcome statement. We want to continue, and at this juncture, we will be asking our disc jockey to set something good for our first performer tonight. Something good, yeah. Well, I don't know much about Miranda, but I've seen a beautiful woman every time I go to the president's house, his little daughter, and we will judge for ourselves tonight, because she has great talent, and we will call Miranda now, all right? Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Disc Jockey, got something good? Miranda is about to set this place on fire. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together loud for Miranda Sandy as she comes out. The sporty flow.
If I tell you that I love you, my money, my body, now your own, baby. Party vision for the account, yo. Versace and Gucci for your body.
I know.
standing. Congratulations, Miranda. We're gonna bring you back one more time. This time we're gonna go up tempo, so you can bring new strokes. Just put it right. Just sit down. You put it around the table. Yeah. Good hustle.
Make sure everything is picked up before you go, my guy.
Miranda, go relax, babe. You're not like, yeah? You do that thing again.
President of Liberia, Mr. Coffey, Mr. Abraham Massaleh, former president, Press Union of Liberia. He used to be my boss at the Press Union of Liberia. Fellow colleagues of the inkjet profession, ladies and gentlemen. And of course, I also like to recognize Mr. Joseph Tay and Joseph Batwell, stars of the inkjet profession. The setting is at the president's office on Camp Johnson Road. And I was just appointed as acting secretary general. Mr. Massaleh became I was appointed as assistant secretary general, and Mr. A.B. Massaleh became the acting secretary general. I just came for an event and I wanted to do a press release. I sat behind my desk, and Masari was sitting just across from me. And I said to him, I'm doing the press release. And then he looked at me and said, who authorized me to do press release? And I said, but I just came from the program, and I wanted to do the press release. I said, who authorized you to do press release? I am the Secretary General. I have not authorized you. You can do no press release. I almost responded, but I sat quietly and asked myself, what is this? This God is too steam. And from that time, Marceline and I became good co-workers. Why? Because I'm steam and he's steam. But we don't act the same time. So when he becomes steam, I'm calm. When I start getting steam, he's calm. So what am I telling this story? Leadership is about give and take. It is about understanding. It is about appreciating each other. Because each of us has a role to play. And until you get the support of those who are working with you, you are on your own. My time with the president, I developed myself what I call the tripartite leadership model. And that tripartite leadership model has to do with the president, the executive, and the body. But in journalism, we have something called the inverted pyramid. So when you turn that pyramid upside down, is the electors, who are the power brokers, the executive committee, then the president. So the president in no way has superpower on the organization. He is elected by the people. He must answer to them. And he has a leadership team he must also answer to. So with that pyramid in place, the power broker who happen to be the people who elect us should be respected at all costs. That's leadership. So this evening we've re-elected our friend and brother, Mose Sandy. From this time forward, Moses, Joe Mason, and our new Secretary General are going to be at the helm of authority. But this does not mean that they're going to be law and order unto themselves. Leadership comes with serious responsibility, and that is do what you want people to do unto you. Do unto others as you have them do unto you. Respect is not demanded, respect is earned. So you can never say, do what I say, but don't do what I do. So as I'm about to install these beautiful officers into office, I want to encourage them to take what they're about to enter very seriously. Moses has exhibited that. Brother John Mason has exhibited that, and I know Crawford will also exhibit that. So without any much ado, I will now take the honor and the privilege to invite up here the officers elect, Mr. Honorable Moses Sandy. Honorable Joe Mason. Those applause gonna be much louder than that. And the Secretary General elect Charles Crawford. I'm gonna grab my Bible. Yeah. When I picked up the Bible, somebody said, I don't want to swear to the Bible, but you got to swear tonight. I hold in my hand a Bible upon which my good friends.
Welcome to the induction ceremonies
and the Bible Code of Professors, the
Associations of Liberian Journalists based here in the U.S.
I know they are not going to
take taking place in this Delaware,
because it is my important
Liberian Public Radio. We are bringing you this live coverage.
This afternoon,
Is the former secretary of PUL. Let us go right back.
And he said, he comes to the office with no agenda, but with the agenda of ALJA. That means the president is the visionary as he takes the oath of office. But being a visionary does not mean you don't listen to pieces of the lies. Right? So we need each other. I want you to repeat after me. When I say I, Nasua Dede, for you, you're going to call your name in your respective offices. And then you can follow. I.
Yeah, put
that right, please.
I, Moses Sandy.
Vice President. Joe Mason, Vice President.
Charles Crawford, Secretary General.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will.
Diligently.
Faithfully.
And with seriousness.
The offices
of President,
Vice President,
and to the best of my ability, I'm going to respect and abide by
the Constitution
of ALJA. And so help me God. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor to present to you the newly elected and now inducted officers of the Association of Liberian Journalists in the Americas, your leaders. Thank you very much. I bring you fraternal greetings from, most of you might not know him, Willie Buya. He asked me to convey to this conference his joy that this third convention is going on, but he could not come because he just underwent a successful kidney transplant in the DC area. So he sends his loving and respectful greetings to all of you. And Mr. President, he wishes he would have been here. But because of the situation, he could not make it. So he wants you to know you have his support, his respect, and admiration. Thank you for your cooperation, and God bless you all.
Thank you. So, Mr. President, Vice President, Secretary General, you now are charged with the responsibility to charter a new course for this organization. We want you to take us to Noble Heights with support of the board and the body. You're sure to succeed. Well, we're going to breach protocol a little bit. I have my co-host. And it's time for us to just laugh. The guy is crazy. He's stupid. That's the way he laughs. Yeah, he's stupid. So put your hands together for one of Liberia's premier comedians, Mr. Quincy T. Then he will laugh and then he will pee.
How you doing, good people? I bring you greetings from Liberia. Liberia there is sweet. I came with my Liberian flag. It's at the residence. And I want to encourage you, please try and get up just one small flag. As you can see what's happening in the world today, I think the world is coming to an end. And you may not want to go to hell two times. Because God will interview you and find out that your life was bad. And he wants to send you to hell. All you have to do is just wave your LIB flag. Tell him I've been there already. Don't send me for the second time. They had that in that hand as nothing. You can't get hard time in Liberia and go to hell and get hard time again. No, it's not possible. You've had the experience, so you are a guru. That country? Bittersweet. Bittersweet. That's how you're looking. But the bitter part too much. But the sweet part. But you see, I tell God, thank you. I know plenty of people in government. So the government need to employ me. I can call it for them every weekend. They want that big brother down there throwing his what? You like it. These are some of the benefits we get.
Yeah.
The people are there, no money there. Not about them for you. Just make sure they get to know the minister, deputy, and developers.
The
gas label. I call it papa pa. You go so you also pa. You can't hear you also pa. You go on this pa. That's how we survive it. Liberia there, you know. But you see, there America here too, y'all will confuse us. Yeah. I saw Liberian women there. Let me look around for it. None of you work with, none of you work with here, right? No, normally they say you can't talk say somebody fat here. You know, the person too fat. They say you can't say it. Uh-huh. So I developed name for them. I can call them 44 continents. I went to one party, the first party they carried me to. The women kept looking at me, but nobody won't talk. By the time my in-law said, that's Quincy T over there, all of them. Yeah, man! Ah! But Quincy T, I beg you, I take it exercise, my stomach is getting big, but it's not too big. I said, but I'm not asking you. The only thing I want to suggest, all those who've been here for more than 15, 20 years, I want you to take a vacation to go and see how Liberia is looking. I will sponsor the trip. Oh, they got interested. Everybody has. I said, but we can't take plane, but plane, because plane can't take you. We got to get one of the old oil tankers that ship will carry you. Because the sizes, they're not small thing. You sit down here, left food to reach you to that level. Hey! I was at the repast today. Some of the Liberian women they were trying to get verbal, I still give it to them. Because in Monrovia now, most of the women won't wear Brazilian hair. And it's expensive. You pay $300, maybe that get one part. Amen. And they will tell you, say, baby, I need about 3 or 4 part. That 1,002 US. That 1,002, you buy that brace, you can take to landlord in 6 months. You can buy crush rice, you can buy cement, black, they will tear the horse up and put zinc. But you decide to put it in your hair. When they hear new, you know what they do? Watch the women. When they put, they put new hair in their hair, when you're talking to them, as long as they talk small, They want you to see that new hair. After 2 weeks, that one finger they can juke inside. Yeah, oh yeah. They getting old, but ain't rich. You always see them juking finger inside. When 1 month pass, went to 1 month, 2 weeks, that one that old hair now, they wouldn't think you see them doing now, they get it. Get a less inside. You know I like to deal with the women? They give me a hard time. We try to tell Jesus to come, but Jesus said wasting time. And now he say, ha! Look, imagine a woman, God made you beautiful. Look, let me tell you, God gave you a blessing every day. He can send it in your Gabriel. This blessing is for our sister Felicia. Please take it to her. Yeah, her picture. The angel can he reach, he can recognize you. Almost 75% of the thing you get on you that rubber. First hair, four eyelashes, four eyelids, four lipstick, four fingernails, four toenails, four titties, four tombs. Your hair to bump it up. Hello? I gave up when I saw first bump. I said, this is the end of the story. Always told my friends, anytime you're going out, if you're going to meet a lady, always hear small needle or sharp pin. When she tells you, say, honey, let's dance. Don't say no. Be dancing. Get put in your pocket, take your pin. Stop me doing it. This small one, you juke her body, she shake that first boy. But you will juke more pins when I say, ah, Sonny, do me. They think they're attractive, they can wear A. Y'all get liver here tonight, right? No, you see, a lot of people don't know that God made men to create alcohol so that the ugly women can find husband. You don't know that? When a man is drunk, you don't look for beauty. Anything you see, you get. When the liver clear from his arm, even if we ring, we force it to ring. Yeah, you're calling the, we want, man. And that the only one let us stay there also. No, but you know, Liberian women are beautiful. You're glad for yourself, man.
Well, I'm sure this one has a big empty dream.
Our country, I keep saying this. When a Liberian man wants to buy a car, he comes to America.
I'm called Crystal.
He won't go to school. Come to America. You want your children to foster their education, whatever? America. A wife won't deliver? America. You want buy a house? America. Everything America. But by the time you get old, you want that. Then you're going to be, please, y'all, please carry me home when I'm done. They're going to agree, yeah? You know he won't be living there? I don't understand why y'all would just choose that. Only when you want that, at the time you will get your home. People living there. I joined a church one time. I regretted why I joined that church. You know, the Catholic people, they understand the early morning mass. I think my Catholic brother here. When they say they go to early morning mass, they understand it. But the charismatic churches that are coming up, they don't understand that before you go to early morning, you got to brush your teeth. Then imagine they tell us early morning, plenty of people don't brush teeth, they go to church. And those are churches where the pastor can tell you, say, look at your neighbor and say, never! Oh, one service. What? I will never forget. Pastor looking at us, he said, I'm going to tell my neighbor that he's beautiful. Before I could turn to the guy to say, nay, I ain't even call the ball. And he did with him on me. They break on the guy said, me. That one woman I had to get a ball. I just turned around and said, ball. What? That's someone said. And you know, the charismatic churches, they are very lively. Holy Ghost fire dancing. Women, when you're going, their attachment, you're always sticking blue. You're either blue or your post-strong helping. We each pastor says swing for Jesus. That girl go get her there. I saw the head pass in front of me. I thought I was a demon. I said, Holy Ghost with fire rebuke you. Now we have all said well. Then when I go take the sahur, I see one woman with all stacking yammer on him. I said, what are you doing here? The woman said, about head and people, yes, are you? I said, what? The worst place I ever gave up, I said, no, I'm coming back to the church. The pastor decided to do feet washing. He said in the Bible, Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. So he won't wash everybody's feet. They buckle in the church, that means they bust us. Then I said, he let him wash his ass when he says stink toes. What? That my first time to see pastor reject somebody's feet. You got to take off your shoes, you sit in the chair, you get your foot to the pastor, he will wash it and wipe it with the towel. When I boss send a foot to the pastor, pastor send a foot back. Say, you're putting me water in bottle, let him go wash your own feet to the house. I've never seen anything like that. Can you imagine, JJ? Look, I think today, those who are at the funeral this morning, after the pastor preached, he said, it was an altar call. If you want to give your life to Christ, please come to the altar. The man didn't say anything in the church. Nobody won't go to the altar. He said, Yoshi, you feel like you're too big for Jesus? Why you were talking there? Dr. Mel Jones put your hand. He said, excuse me, pastor. Pastor said, but dying you baptized. He said, no, I want to say something. He took the microphone. He said, look, there's no need to be ashamed. There's nothing to be ashamed of. I became a Christian. I was almost 30 years old. I gave my life to Christ. So if you're out there, don't be ashamed. Come to this altar and give your life to Christ. I want that way. I say, Dr. June, the way you spoke, I was ashamed for about I come here to give my life. Dr. June said, Jeff for coming up. Driver, go in the car, bring $50,000, give it to the man. Any other person you want to get a life, the pastor put in or he said, I want to give my life to Christ. Money business can inside. Pastor, Lord, give me a life. Somebody. Hey. Money, baby. You know that the two other guys are who get a ball here. By enjoying your, you know, ball here people, they always face problems in wiping their face. Because no hair on their head, they can always start from behind here before they can come all the way in front. Before I take my seat, Let me just give this piece of advice. It's always good sometimes when they call you to speak a program. Prepare your small speech. Pull in your party. Be sure in. My man, I've never seen embarrassment in my life like that. The bugger boy is speaking in a party, trying to go get in a car. The car was far from him, something that rain came down, wet the coat, ran back to the house. Change the code, forgot to take the speech from the packet. He get put on new code, got in the car, went to this function. He was already late. As he entered, they started introducing the guest speaker. They call him to the platform. I bug on the platform, man. All you do is prepare. Kosu. Mr. Principal, Vice Principal. When he hit member of the faculty, then he checked in the front left packet. Member of the faculty, nothing there. Member of the student body, the student ladies, and gentlemen here present. They play partner and now you were checking the member of the diplomatic group. I said, but you put partner here to take speech from there? That boy just turned around to the director of the prison and said, look, anytime this print plan nonsense for you, you must just follow all of them. I said, My big brother over there, he went, I will not call the person name, but the person get airplane. He said I should. Maybe if I finish with you all, but I'm not calling nobody name up here before you carry my name. My man get a plane. They can call it air keke. You know they got one small motorbike in Monrovia. Four person can sit inside, only four. Let's say three seats plus the driver, so that four. Yeah, the baja. But we call it keke. The plane, you get only four seats, so we call the plane a keke. They say, pack a spring fee. He said, no, you won't pack a raw fee.
Just to travel here, go everywhere, Abuja and come back. The people in the airport, the plane, it start giving problem. The pilot said, one of the engines of the plane got a little problem, but don't worry, we got another engine here. We manage to reach some kind of way. He turned around to the deputy. He said, "Mane, the way they say the engine giving problem, if the other engine gave problem, that means we still don't up here for long." I said, "Who told you when the two engine girl, you'll be there? You'll be where? Up where?" Finally, one day, one day came to my head, yes, now. No, now, women. Yeah, man. Why you want me to put my money women there? Finally, you know that most times on our level, deal with the pastor there, you know. Because the pastor there, they got plenty of interesting story. I attended a church where they call for a special service called, you know what I mean? Pastor said, nobody will brush their teeth for 1 week. Just talk to God. Yeah, water will not get in your mouth. It was a fast. Just talk to God. Morning, afternoon, evening, people just talking to God, talking to God. He said, God will deliver. He must show his presence. No brush, don't put no food, nothing. We did that thing. Me, I used to sleep miss on this. Yet God, I couldn't stand it. I would go brush. We went to church. They call it service. Oh, service. Look in your member, the neighbor face, and get Holy Ghost fire. What? What? One guy called in my face. A pastor. Janet, thank you, my sister. When the guy called, I dropped. The pastor said, the demon in that man, you bring him up here. Holy Ghost fire. That's him, he's the one. How do God live for the heavy body? Drag me, carry to the altar. Pastor said, I want 7 persons to come and over him. I saw them running, coming. When I opened my eyes, they see God and made me feel it over the morning. I said, Pastor, I'm healed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for Pastor T. My left eye watering. You will come back so you can make the right eye watering. By popular demand, do we want him again? All right, good. So we'll continue the program and we'll come back to Queenston. Quickly, we want to go to an island on the agenda here tonight, and it will be introduction of our guest speaker. This task will be performed by Mrs. Akai Bladen. Ladies and gentlemen, please give her a round of applause. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. All protocol observed. I'm sorry, let me do what Quincetti said. La Brazilian weave. Our guest speaker tonight, Mr. Abraham Gassimu Masale, was born in Kawaje, now referred to as Kawala Home in Soko Clan, Bokpa District, Grand Kibmai County, Liberia. Abraham said his great-grandfather was a Gola warrior, hunted elephants in the Mana River area, and was tribal custodian of the land, including the mines area. But he said his people had no say. When the Liberian government concluded concession agreement in the 1980s to operate Liberia's first iron ore mining First Iron Ore Mining Company, the National Iron Ore Company. When the mines were in full operation, he laments that his people became the first casualty of pollution and environmental damages in Liberia. Abraham said the murky red water from the iron ore washing plant ran down the Mana River, which was the only source of drinking water for many local people. Abraham said as a kid, he questioned why the river was sometimes red and why they had to walk from the Mana River to his hometown almost half a day's journey for weekends when others drove cars on gravel roads, sending dust into their faces. He said he also questioned why the roads were only constructed in the Mana River area, and why his humiliation or questioned their sufferings, why their land was being exploited without any benefit to the local inhabitants. Abraham said he was inspired by the suffering and humiliation of his people, and in his early years, he was recruited among all the local students by the then Progressive Alliance of Liberia as a cadet to help invoke political change in Liberia. VANQUET has spread its operations to Cape Mount and many parts of Liberia, and the organization had become a force to reckon with. Hence, he became a product of the progressive movement. In the early 1980s, Abraham said he was one of the ringleaders that led demonstration in Tubmanburg, Benue County, against the People's Redemption Council military regime to advance the cause of education. He said he was marching in the front row when he encountered the then Secretary General of the PRC, who pointed a gun to his forehead and threatened to blow up his brain. He said he was also a ringleader of the student protests in Rabospoe against the military administration, who used to order students to work in the swamp during rest conservation in response to the military government's Green Revolution program. He says students' communal labor was abolished in Rabospoe on that date of the student protests. According to his account, Abraham said, they took over the planned demonstration in June 1990 when the religious leaders of Liberia, Liberia Council of Churches, and the Interfaith failed to show up at their own planned march, which was to start from the capital bypass. He said they led the march at a time where rebels had already put Monrovia on a siege. He said they were met with resistance from AFL soldiers at the BTC barracks, who blocked them from marching to the executive mansion to demand the resignation of President Dole. He said he was in the front row of the march, and with guns pointed directly to them, he was injured during the scuffle. Mr. Massley is the former president of the University of Liberia Student Union. His administration reconstructed the student union building at a cost of over $20,000. The building was destroyed during the Liberian Civil War, and his administration rewrote the OSU Constitution as a way of bringing reform to OSU and provided over 1,000 scholarships, the largest for any student government before him. His student-led government established typing pool to ease problems with producing term papers. It was also a strong advocate for, I think, Ecomon, especially in the face of the smell campaign by Wallace. Now, ladies and gentlemen, join me as we welcome our distinguished keynote speaker, Mr. Abraham Gassimo Masale.
Thank you for that beautiful introduction. I know a lot of you know me as a journalist, but many of you don't know me in my progressive movement. So I just wanted to highlight where we come from and where we are today. My beautiful wife is here, Mrs. Victoria Masale. I want to first recognize you. The president of ALJA, Mr. Moses Sandy. Mr. Charles Coffey, the PUA president. My friend and brother, Suadede. You know, we come a very long way. I didn't just do your story today about me and him. So both of us were kind of high-headed, like Brent would say. But at the time, press union needed high-headed people. But ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you so much for this privilege. Before I go into my speech, I just want to give you a little story. When I came here in the 90s, in the late 90s, I had a job, and I was very excited about that office job. So we want to eat, and I was in line to get my food. And behind there later, our director, the guy who controlled the whole place, I think, and his deputy came and stood behind me. And I just come from Liberia not too long ago, and you know the tradition there. So I left the line, I went at the back. So when I was going, he said, "Where you going?" I said, "I'm going to buy." He said, "Why?" I said, "Out of respect for you." He said, "No, we don't do that here. You stay in line." He said, "I can't let, so I got to take food after you." So I was shocked, and you know, I said, "Why would this guy, you know, who runs the show, you know, ask me to eat before him?" But it didn't take long when I saw Bill Clinton in the Virginia area, standing in line to get McDonald's. You know, it was a real cultural shock to me that, you know, leaders of this country who people admire and they also revere, and they would take bike seat to ordinary citizens. You know, I was shocked about that. But that just tells you the topic that we want to discuss, the rule of law. When I went to Florida a couple of years ago, I actually had some problems, so I almost missed my flight. And when I went, they have almost closed the cabin. So when the security guy said, "Where you going?" He said, "I'm going for the death phase." "So you're too late." He said, "They just closed the cabin and nobody's allowed to enter." I said, "Wow, this is a regional area, so I won't be able to go to job the next 3 days." He said, "Oh, really?" I said, "Yes." So the guy went, he told the other security, and they were all white people. And I was shocked in about 5 minutes for this white guy to get down from the plane, and this black boy was allowed to get in the plane. So that's rule of law. And that's what we want to discuss tonight. Since my return from Liberia in 2013, This is my second public statement about the state of affairs in our homeland. I prefer to observe for now, but my friend, Mr. Moses Sandy, the president of the Association of Liberian Journalists in the Americas, prevailed on me to give this statement. Let me seize this opportunity to thank Mr. Sandy for the tremendous efforts he has single-handedly made to bring ALJA to this outstanding level of progress. And I also want to seize this opportunity to salute his charming wife, Marion. She's been a real supportive individual of ALJA. And I must commend her as well. While many are disappointed about the events back home, which has unmotivated them to be active in Liberian diaspora organizations, Mr. Sandy has become the cohesive force that is holding ALJA together. He was the trailblazer in revitalizing ALJA, and since then, he has remained unwavering. The text messages keep coming almost weekly from him, even if you do not reply or get involved. This is remarkable leadership. Thank you, my dear brother. In line with this year's ALJA team, I will address you on the topic, the rule of law for a stable and peaceful Liberia. But let me quickly remind you that this is a very broad topic. I will really focus on the harsh realities facing our nation, which is the absence of the rule of law that is undermining the peace and stability, and offer some suggestions. Ladies and gentlemen, we must take a review of where we are as a nation as we begin the transition to another elected government. I know we all have different perspectives about the situation back home, and this is my perspective. We have gathered today at a very crucial time in our national history. Less than a month from now, our country will elect a new government. To me, this is a significant progress for a country out of 40 years of war to have three successive elections and a peaceful transition to a new government. I commend the international community and the UN peacekeeping mission in Liberia for their support in peace building. However, I do believe that the real credit belongs to the Liberian people for the peace we continue to enjoy. Our people have resigned not to fight war anymore. For 12 years, they have borne the pain, the grief, the anguish, the neglect, the frustration, and the disappointment. But they have realized that violence is not the answer to our national problems. For 12 years, they have kept their calm to maintain peace and stability in our country. This is praiseworthy, and this is a blessing that we know war no more. But this government exploited the fact that the people are exhausted from war. The human sufferings in Liberia are unimaginable. The family structure, especially in the Monrovia area, has severely broken down due to extreme poverty. Prostitution is a major problem. Children are left to fend for themselves or to assume adult responsibilities. If you cannot provide for your child, you lost influence and control and sometimes respect from that child. Those who provide exert influence and control During my visit to Liberia in 2013, in a taxi cab on Broad Street, a girl, likely in her early teens, remarked to her friend that her mother always asks her where she is going, but the mother cannot even buy her painting. I was born in poverty, but my people had hope for a better future. And this is why I stand before you today. Our mothers who couldn't read and write sold their wheat markets and sent us to school. And our fathers worked hard in spite of their excruciating circumstances to keep their families together. Our people kept their pride. They worked hard. They had integrity. They were honest. And more importantly, they kept their word. They knew someday, somehow, their children, you and me, will have a better future than they. But my friends, this hope has vanished in the land of survival of the fittest, where the weak is perishing by the day. It is no longer about tomorrow in Liberia. It is about what I can get now. Besides the human sufferings, the country is still in infrastructure crisis. Our roads are merely unpaved, many impassable during the rainy season, and our bridges are in deplorable shape. Our health system is in shambles. Our educational system is a national disgrace. Nearly the entire country is unemployed. My friends, our country, Liberia, is more vulnerable to violence today than any time in my lifetime. I say so because when the people are hungry, impoverished, hopeless, and idle, and have nothing to live for, this is a recipe for chaos. Moreover, institutions of government are weaker today, and our public officials today, elected and appointed, are the least, let me repeat, the least respected at any time in my lifetime. The culture of impunity rules supreme in Liberia. The rule of law does not apply to our government and to our public officials, including senators and representatives. They are above the law. The legislature is a joke. Our courts have not demonstrated independence. Our institutions of government are in no better shape today than President Sirleaf met them, and in many instances, even worse. President Sirleaf simply failed to lead. Sometimes I wonder whether this is sheer incompetence or revenge for native woman-born soldier. Our armed forces, including the AFL and the police, are not adequate in number and strength and are not well equipped for our common defense. Our security and our security, while training and discipline, remains a huge challenge. This is why the government has kept on begging for the UN peacekeeping mission in Liberia to stay. Our armed forces, including the police, lack incentives, and their morale is the lowest ever. Former members of the AFL remain disgruntled about their retirement benefits. On the flip side, I have never seen such gross disparity between many public officials and those at the lowest end of the spectrum, the people begging for crumbs to survive. The grievances for 1980 and the war are almost being replayed. and the country is already drifting from peace and stability. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe the Salif government was the most vulnerable to violence than any administration before her. Yet she did nothing serious about our common security because she relied heavily on foreign troops, leaving our people to armed robbers. But thank God there was not a single firecracker incident in Monrovia. President Salif was presented with the best opportunity for Liberia's development than any other Liberian president before her, but she squandered that opportunity. The entire country embraced her leadership, but it was not so with President Talbot, Doe, and Taylor. She had two uninterrupted, quiet, successive six-year terms with the backing of UN peacekeepers. There has never been any darling of the West among Liberian presidents than President Salif. She is in the elite club of very few African presidents who have addressed the United States Joint Congress. The international community provided billions of dollars in aid under her leadership. In 2011 alone, which was election year in Liberia, Liberia received $765 million in official development assistance. In 2010, Liberia got $4.6 billion in debt relief from the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, and the World Bank under the heavily indebted poor countries initiative. I do believe, that awarding the Nobel Peace Prize to President Salif was based on misinformation and was a bad example in promoting the cause of peace, justice, and the rule of law, accountability, and human dignity in Africa. The most I expected was for her to lay a foundation for good governance, accountability, and the rule of law upon which our country will grow and prosper, and to establish a vision for growth and prosperity. But she shattered the hope of the nation. The Bible says, to whom much is given, to whom much is expected. This is why the disappointment in President Salif is so huge. Last year, Front Page Africa reported a massive fall in the United States government support to Liberia. Front Page said experts were guessing whether this was due to corruption or the lack of confidence in President Salif. I am sure even the international community is disappointed in her leadership. I don't think history will be kind to her. Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest threat to peace and stability now facing Liberia is the uncontrollable corruption. Public officials have become emboldened right in your face corruption due to the absence of the rule of law and the impunity culture that has become deeply entrenched. Corruption is a national emergency and a disaster in waiting, capable of wrecking our country and our peace. I hope the new president to be elected in October will move swiftly to tackle this disease. The level of corruption in Liberia is clearly not sustainable. The Salif administration adopted a budget that was a perfect recipe for corruption. About 86.5% of Liberia's budget under President Salif went to compensation of government employees, middle government officials. Only about 13.5% went to capital expenditure, such as building roads and schools. Of the $526.6 million in this year's budget, 2017 and 2018 budget, $296 million was allocated for compensation of employees. This is not the kind of budget that will fix our roads, fix our school system, improve our health care, and provide basic services to our people. Ladies and gentlemen, another serious issue facing Liberia today is the dramatic shift in the mindset of our people, both in and outside the government, to make fast and easy money, even through dishonest means, and the political patronage that has evolved. The government bankrolls public officials with thousands of dollars each month, and our people stand in line to get crumbs from these public officials. This is the new normal in Liberia. The desperation to get quick money is damaging the spirit and motivation of the people to realize their full potential. It is eroding their self-esteem and pride. Integrity has become a scarce commodity in the country. Character has vanished, almost vanished. Dishonesty is king. Ethics and morality are almost depleted. Value is becoming extinct, and love for country is almost a thing of the past. My good friends, this fast cash syndrome, to make money fast or to get a lot of money easily and quickly, has gripped Liberia like a wildfire, and is more destructive than a war. The war destroyed the physical capacity of the country, that is the infrastructure. But this money disease is destroying the cognitive capacity, which is the mental capacity of the country. With thousands of dollars being shoveled to our public officials, and when individuals and authorities in government are not being held accountable to our laws, the race is on to grab what he can. The sad reality is that our government is not being ruled by the rule of law, and law and order is not applied to our public officials. Unfortunately, most organizations that were in the vanguard or crusaders for good governance and the rule of law have become silent. The Liberian National Student Union, LINSU, and the Federation of Liberian Youth, FLY, are now on government payroll. President Sirleaf used soft power to keep the students quiet and the legislature in check, but grossly neglected to lead. Perhaps the biggest chopping area in Liberia today is the national legislature. No wonder why so many candidates for the legislature are seeking one elected seat in one district. It is no longer about public service in Liberia, but it's about the fat money the government is dishing out. There is no doubt on my mind that the 53rd National Legislature was corrupt, weak, and ineffective. There are few individuals in the legislature who still earn my respect, but as an institution, the 53rd Legislature was a mess. Dishing out thousands of dollars per month to individual legislators, some of whom could not even earn $500 in a whole year, play a huge role in weakening the legislature. The numerous leadership crises in both houses, seemingly orchestrated by the executive, also contributed significantly to weakening the legislature. It started with Edwin Snow, and Isaac Yenabo became a trophy to show that you cannot mess with this mama. Unfortunately, Liberia is the only country where there is no ruling party and no opposition. With a very weak political structure and political parties, senators and representatives cross party lines to form majority bloc where the grass is greener. With an inept legislature, the country was left to the mercy of an imperial presidency for 12 years, and lamentably, there was no mercy. Our courts are not strong. Our Supreme Court has not exemplified itself. Our people have no faith in our courts. And arguably, accessible and impartial dispute resolution through the courts is a key principle of the rule of law and the foundation for political stability, sustainable peace, capital investment, and economic prosperity. My good friends in the media itself has its own problems. News articles such as press releases have become very expensive to be published in newspapers or broadcast. I am not indicting all newspapers and all radio stations in Liberia, but this has become a major hurdle to press freedom and expression. News articles should really be free. I was very outspoken when my public relations budget got bigger and bigger. As former president of the Press Union of Liberia, I believe that no matter the financial situation in Liberia, the biggest bidder should not get the front page headlines in our newspapers. The level of press freedom we enjoy today in Liberia was not given to us on silver platter or by a benevolent president. This is something many journalists fought and died for, and this is something many of us seriously risked our lives for, and under God's grace, we are here today to witness. Therefore, the minimum we can do as journalists is to honor the memories of those fallen journalists by our best practices. Additionally, our religious leaders have become silent, absent in our national dialogue. The likes of Bishop Michael K. Francis are no more in our churches and our mosques, as they have muted themselves in these last 12 years. But my friends, advocacy, citizen advocacy, is a critical and vital role in maintaining the rule of law and accountability. My dear Liberians, this October will offer a new opportunity for us as a people to start anew, dream big dreams again, and rekindle hope, but it has to start with free, fair, credible, and transparent elections. Judging from the recent experience in Kenya, international observers must not rush to declaring the election free, fair, and transparent without complete, concrete, and tangible facts. The Supreme Court itself must exercise prudence and wisdom in deciding any elections dispute and maybe earn some respect and trust. The new president should convene a sovereign national conference to discuss and resolve the outstanding issues of reconciliation, the constitution, and governance. Lamentably, efforts to amend the constitution are blocked in the legislature because the legislators are opposed to reduction of their terms. 2 years ago, and this is a true story, 2 years ago, a senator told me that there will be no referendum in 2017. And he said, as long as he is in the Senate, there will be no reduction in term for the Senate until at least 18 years, arguing that the 9-year term was too short. He said, and this is what really bothered me, he said, and I quote, "I am not like George Washington. I am not like Benjamin Franklin, who loved their country so much that they could have become king, but decided to give power to the people." This is a senator that was speaking to me. senators who are supposed to be honorable, wise men and women, people of integrity, character, sound judgment, moral rectitude, and positive role models are the most disappointing. Elected to 9-year terms, they have become untouchable and loyal unto themselves. The new president will have to assert himself or herself to put a halt to this madness that is going on in our country. The new president will have to muster the political will to instill accountability. The fight against corruption will be the first test case for the new president in ensuring adherence to the rule of law and accountability. The AFL needs to be at appropriate troop level for our common defense, and the police need to have proper numerical strength for our common security and safety. These are among the urgent issues facing our country. The resolution to these issues by the new government will bring about accountability, transparency, as well as adherence to the rule of law, which are the pillars, the basic pillars for a functioning government and a recipe for a peaceful and stable Liberia. Finally, for many of us in this room, and in our generation, our tomorrow is here. This is our future. The older you get, the more selfish and self-centered you become. This is human nature. Life is short. But my friends, the things we do or fail to do live long after us. It becomes our legacy. And history is harsh. I plead with you, don't be selfish to Liberia. Our country needs your help, your talents, and your expertise. Don't give up on our country. No matter how angry you are with corruption in Liberia or with Ellen, don't be angry with the entire country. Don't be angry with Sando County. Don't be angry with Cape Mount. Don't be angry with Bombay. Don't be angry with Rosas and all other counties. And don't be angry with your homeland and your hometown. There is plenty of blame to go around for what has happened to our country. But you, my friends, can be that difference for our people. Do something. Do anything to help Liberia. I thank you.
Well, that's Mr. Ibrahim Asale is the former president of the President of Liberia, keynoting the 7th annual conventions of ALJA right here. And he was very forceful in his argument of President Helen Johnson Sirleaf's failure to practice good governance, failure to the trust imposed in her by the international community. Ibrahim Asaleh, very forceful in his presentation here this evening at the 7th Annual Convention of ALJA. This is a presentation sort of the Liberia Public Radio. We'll bring you live coverage this evening in Newcastle, Delaware, United States of America. Well, ALJA 7th Annual Convention.
Ladies and gentlemen,
let's go to Fukano Shapton,
President for the second term.
Director. And he has the inaugural Master of Ceremony.
So we'll have to hear his speech tonight. Let's give it up for Mr. Moses, descending National President of ALJA, to give us his inaugural address. I already doing it again. Time. Observe the protocol. Time.
Now, during today's deliberation, President Moses Sandy was re-elected by delegates at the 7th Annual Convention right here in Delaware.
Tonight, the President-elect,
Ibrahim Asaleh, is speaking. And we'll go right back to the podium for the President's inaugural address.
Mr. Charles Coffey, current President of the PEO, the Reverend Suad Dede, a former president of the PEL 2017 induction officer. Mr. J. Wesley Washington, Assistant Minister for Public Affairs at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Republic of Liberia. Mr. Joe Bissing, our newly inducted Vice President of the Association of Liberian Journalists in America, ALJA. Our newly inducted Secretary General, Mr. Charles Crawford, members of the ALJA family, Mr. Volcano Shelton, our newly elected and inducted Chair of the National Board of Directors of ALJA, Mr. Alfonso Yunam, Chair of the ALJA family, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Before I proceed with my statement, I would like to kindly appeal to you to please rise and observe a moment of silence for all fallen journalists the world over, including Liberians. Thank you. Have your seats. Time is far spent, so I will just do a little bit of summary here. I want to express my heartfelt gratitude to my colleagues working from across the Americas to re-elect me as ALJA National President. I want to tell you thank you for the opportunity they gave me for another 2 years. This did not come as a surprise, given the level of work we have done over the years in getting ALJA to where it is today. After 10 years of dormancy as a result of internal strife, we took on the challenge, and today we have an ALJA that we all, as journalists in the Americas, are proud of. Thank you for the support you continue to give us, your moral and financial support. At this time, having been fully inducted as president for the next 2 years, I would at this time like to call on the members and the chairman of the ALJA ACOG Elections Commission. So as I call you, I would like for you to come forward for the dissolution of the ACOG Elections Commission. Mr. Alfonso Yunam, chairman of the ALJA Elections Commission. Commissioner Akai Glading. Commissioner James Sibley, Commissioner Wilmot Kayu. Commissioner Moba Duana, please come forward. Is Mr. Duana here? Well, Chairman Yunam and members of the ACOG Elections Commission, on behalf of the ALJA National Administration and the newly inducted team, I want to take this time to publicly express our gratitude to you for a job well done.
with the power vested in me as national president, I would like to declare that the Accor Elections Commission, as of this evening, is hereby dissolved. Job well done, sir. Thank you for a job well done.
We done with the election commission that you done.
Yeah, thank you.
We have come.
That was President Moses Sandy calling for the dissolution of the ALJA election commission. He was elected today, but now he's been inducted. So the commission is completely dissolved. So let us go back to President Sandy's remarks.
The next 2 years, I'm sure you want to hear from me on that. We want to continue to consolidate the peace in ALJA. We want to continue to bring our people together. That's one of the fundamental reasons why this organization was established in 1998. We also want to sustain the peace, the good relationship between the President of Liberia and ALJA. We will continue to be a critical voice in defending press freedom in Liberia. The ALJA under my leadership will seek opportunities for media development through training in Liberia. The ALJA under my leadership will be a critical voice in championing the cause of good governance in Liberia. We will speak to those critical issues. We will monitor and we will intervene whenever the need arises. We did it in the past and we continue to do it with your support. In the Americas, we will also continue to reach out to our colleagues wherever they are. Because unless you are on board, there will be no national administration. So we'll reach out. We'll continue with the reconciliation process, which we started 2 years ago. The next time we convene for another convention, we will add another flavor. Our job will continue to go places. We will seek funding. We seek scholarship opportunities for our colleagues in Liberia. We engage our political leaders. We will engage our political leaders because we strongly believe that the government and the press are not enemies. We are partners working in unison for one country, that's Liberia. Studies have shown over the years that national development and press freedom are inseparable. Unless we work together, we cannot achieve anything in Liberia. So our ALJA will continue to tread the path of peace and national development in Liberia. With that said, I would now like to use this opportunity to recognize few individuals who since 2014 have worked tirelessly around the clock
anytime you call the I'm willing, with other things happening in their personal lives, these people are still there for ALJA. Everything we do for ALJA is voluntary. Sometimes we have to go into our personal resources. We don't have no money stuck or somewhere. Everything we put in comes from our individual pockets. And let me just let you know that ALJA is now a fully registered nonprofit entity in the United States. We have elevated ALJA to a different level. We have a website, one of the best, launched on Thursday of this week. You want to check us out? Go to aljaonline.org. So, we didn't do all of these things on our own. We did it with support from key people. And I would like to start with my vice president, Mr. Joe Mason. Is Mr. Mason here? Mr. Joe Mason, could you please come forward? Mr. Mason is indeed a team player. Joe is, besides being a broadcaster, one of the best in Liberia, Joe is also an IT specialist. Whenever we turn to Joe, Joe is always available. All it takes is a phone call. He never says no. He's a team player. Joe, I respect you, and I appreciate you. Thank you. Mr. Gadia Woosin. Mr. Gadia Woosin, our retired Secretary General. Mr. Woosin served from 2014 to 2017. He was elected Secretary General in 2015. And with all the hectic work we do, we don't get no paycheck. All we do is go into our little money and take it and give it to people. So the old man said, look, my man, I'm tired now, man. I need to take a break. But look, our Gadi and I have come a long way, more than 20 years of friendship. He's one of the best when it comes to getting the things in the media. All I need to do is just place a phone call. The stories will be out there. Mr. Woosin, thank you for your good work. We appreciate it. Mr. Charles Crawford, the newly inducted Secretary General. Mr. Crawford, please come forward. You know, Mr. Crawford has good heart. He's a generous person. He was not in national leadership. There were times that we needed help. He would volunteer. He said, look, Moses, I will take on the responsibility. Oh, this other journalist is having this other problem. Charles will say, I will take on that responsibility. That's Mr. Crawford. He supports everything we do. And I'm sure with his elevation to the position of Secretary General, he will make a significant difference. So Charles, I just want to say publicly that we really appreciate you and thank you for all the good work you have done for us. Thank you. Yes. Now, let's bring in some females. You know, it is often said that behind every good man,
Before I was, behind every was successful man, right? There's a good woman. All the big things I do at Ryan, I don't do them by myself. When I tell so, it's my wife. Sometimes she argues with me. She tells me, oh, Moses, you know the people thing here, you know, do this, and the man, just leave there. I will hear no it. But I just want to say that, look, I'm blessed. I'm fortunate to have a woman that has all the attributes of any good woman. My wife is beautiful, right? She's intelligent. She's compassionate, forgiving. She cares. She's generous. She's my pillow. So, I want to say, since I took on it, for everything I do, my wife gives me 100% support. In Delaware, my name resonates in Delaware because of this woman. When I left for state managers, she was there. When I was acting chair of the community, she was there. When I went to ALJA, she took it and put it on her head. She sacrifices. So, Mr. Cindy, I want you to please come forward. Again to do this thing here for the Liberian people.
better give her credit.
I just want to tell every one of you this evening that look, I love this woman. We appreciate you. ALJA appreciates you, man. I mean, my colleagues here are living witnesses. She is the mother of ALJA. She goes the extra mile. I just want to say publicly, thank you. Thank you, Maron, for being there for us. Yeah. Okay. Another woman. Another female. You know, sometimes you make friends. And friends end up becoming a part of your family, even though you people are not connected biologically. When I was in Liberia as a hustler, a reporter at the National Legislature, I ran into a friend called Jackson T. Seaton. Mr. Seaton and I have come a long way. We were reporters. We all used to eat what they call gratuity in Liberia. At the time, our survival hinged on the kindness of people. So, when we migrated to the United States, our relationship again rekindled. I came earlier and he came later. When he came, we connected. The relationship rekindled, and since then, for everything I do, he comes on board. Not only he comes as an individual, he also comes with his wife. I would like to recognize Mrs. Florence Seaton. Mr. Seaton, could you please escort Mr. Seaton? Look, I just had this woman working since what? Yesterday. In fact, she started what? Thursday. Cooking. On charity. We can't even pay for the food. I said, look, Moses, I'll do anything here for you. You don't have to worry. I mean, He went into his personal resources, invested it. If we have several other people like Florence, then ALJA will be more than this. So, Mr. Seaton, I want to say thank you. Thank you for the future you brought to here with you for us. Thanks, Mr. Seaton. We appreciate you.
Yes.
So, with that said, I would like to retire. And before retiring, let me say thanks to all of you for coming this evening, my colleagues from Liberia, led by Mr. Charles Coffey. I want to say thank you. We appreciate all of you for coming. Your time, your support, we appreciate it. Thank you.
One, two. No time. Time, no money. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, please clap for the president one more time. Thank you. We're gonna make some remarks. After the remarks, then we'll laugh a little bit before we wrap up and do some dancing, okay? So, on behalf of the board of directors of ALJA, we're gonna call the deputy vice chairman, the Reverend Dr. Zizit Mada, to make his remark on behalf of the board of directors. Thank you.
Good evening. On behalf of the board of directors of the Association of Liberian Journalists in the Americas, let me use this opportunity to extend our heartfelt thanks and appreciation to all of you, those who have come from far and near to join us in this historic celebration, the third annual gathering of the association. As we forge ahead, as we seek and as we work towards the building of a credible media environment in Liberia, it is indeed the responsibility of all of us who have gathered here, well-wishers and sympathizers, to continue to work towards the building of a vibrant, a democratic Liberia. And though we are here, as we sit here tonight, Liberia is gearing towards the holding of a free and fair elections. That's our hope. And we are looking forward to that. So let me just thank you all for coming, especially those Liberians who've come all the way from Liberia. I'm talking about reporters and the leadership of the press union, and all of our distinguished guests who have gathered here. As we leave tonight, let us leave with the spirit of hope, the spirit of national unity, the spirit of healing. Liberia has a lot to do in the area of reconciliation and national reunification. So as watchdogs of our own society, and as we work towards the building of strategic capacity of the media in Liberia, which is strategically lacking in many ways, it behooves all of us, those of us who have gathered here, who have the interests of the country. Liberia is that one common denominator that we all share. So it is incumbent upon all of us to do the best we can to sustain peace, to encourage development, to encourage reconciliation. And I emphasize reconciliation because I come from a theological and ministerial perspective here tonight, just urging us to be reflective of the fact that we've come a mighty long way in this journey of recovery, in the journey of the destruction that we've gone through and the challenges we have ahead of us. Ethics, just basic morals and responsibilities that is require of people of decency and goodwill, to some extent has vanished and is eroding. And in order to protect our democracy, to make it to grow, to sustain it, it is indeed a responsibility for all of us, those of us who believe in Liberia and know that Liberia is the one common denominator that we all share, to encourage prosperity. In closing, let us encourage peace. Let us encourage reconciliation. Let us work towards national healing and the building of a vibrant Liberia in which all will come to the table, where no one will be left behind, whether you come from the south, east, or from the northern part, or from central Liberia. Liberia belongs to all of us, and it is our vision as ALJA to continue to encourage them, to insist and challenge even those in authority to be accountable to the people of Liberia. Thanks for coming, and even as you leave tonight, when you go to your respective places, let the foreshadow and the glory of God go with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Because of time, we want you to be very brief in your remarks. So we're going to call on the president of the University of Liberia's Alumni Association here in the U.S. Just for a couple of minutes. The president of UL Alumni Association here in the U.S. Let's give him a big hand and clap. Put some light in this thing. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Mr. Guest Speaker, Mr. President, and the new court officers, member of the Board of ALJA, on behalf of the Board of Directors, the Executive Committee, and the entire membership of the University of Liberia Alumni Association in Americas, I bring you greetings and best wishes on your election. I serve as the national president, like you already said. I live in Providence, Rhode Island. When the president called me about this program, I told him, say, there is no difference between the press group and the University of Liberia, because I know most of the folks from ALJA came from LU, like Justin Sisto, the president himself. So I just want to encourage the leadership. You guys are doing a great job, but we can do more. We can help in a rebuilding process of our country. At times, I'm an accountant. I pick up read the online newspaper. We got very good professional people in Liberia writing. But at times, when I read some of the article, it's kind of difficult to wrap my head around it to see where they're actually going. So if we on the side, Mr. President, we can help the folks to upgrade their skills, making them to write something that will be kind of okay, because other people read that, providing them with the basic tools. Yeah, I told the folks from LU, we can get the old computers, textbook, and send it to the school. So in a journalism field, if you can get the old recorder, anything that can help the folks back home to improve them, to build a capacity, will be okay. So I want to encourage other members of ALJA, get on board. This is your profession. Call friends in other states. President Sani has been doing a great job. He continues to do it. We all can help ALJA to be good. And lastly, as our country moves to election, I listened to the guest speaker. He made some very key points. The rule of law. But one thing comes to mind, for me personally, the very rule of law we talk about, there are folks who are in the vanguard of student politics. There were folks at the University of Liberia, but they are the same folks in government today that have forgotten the rule of law. So where they stand? So I hope we in this country, we lead with leadership with passion. But in Liberia, I believe folks carry on leadership with what they can get for themselves. So I, as we approach the election season, let him encourage us, because who knows, Melvin is president for early today. When I leave, he ain't going to like run for government job, so to speak. I have a different vision for the country. That's, I think, will not help the country. Thank you, and God, we still bless you.
Thank you very much. We quickly want to recognize the Liberian Public Radio in the house. Matter of fact, this program is going live both on radio and TV. Thanks to the crew for coming out and supporting. Also, our disc jerky tonight, G. Francis Tokwa, who's spinning the tracks. He's so itchy right now, they want more to play for us so we can dance, right? All right, so we'll be coming to that. We want to continue with brief remarks. A member from the First State Old Timer, I believe is the secretary or chairman. First State Old Timer. Is First State Old Timers here?
Is Mr. Kaba here?
All right, so we'll continue. All right, it's okay. We'll just go to the next one. We want to call on Mr. Charles Coffey, the president, visiting president of the President of Liberia, just to give us a brief remark on probably the state of affairs of the president. Just very brief, maybe he can sum it up in about 3 minutes. Thank you.
Mr. Case Speaker, former President of the President of Liberia, the induction officer and former President of the President of Liberia, Mr. President of ALJA, Mr. G. Wesley Washington, our colleague back there, who, according to the earlier speaker, was in the vanguard seeking help for Liberians, the fight against the deadly Ebola. Fellow Liberians, ladies and gentlemen, the PUL is very grateful to ALJA for this collaboration, and we deem it necessary to foster it to the highest level for the common good of our country. Enlightenment is very essential for the growth of Liberia, because when the people are informed, they make conscious decisions. And during this electoral process, the PUL is involved with this enlightenment, educating the public through various media institutions, radio stations, newspapers, using the community media outlet to reach out to the masses. What we are experiencing in the country is that we're on the right footing. Elections are expected to be peaceful. The people are speaking out through the media institutions. The electorates are questioning those who are vying for various positions, their ability to lead the country. We have demanded areas that have been discussed: corruption, infrastructure development, youth empowerment, women empowerment, and all other areas intended to ensure the restoration of basic social services. These candidates in different dimensions are promising the Liberian people that they are going to do their best. October 10th is around the corner. So we want to praise ALJA for this initiative. We need collaboration. Liberia is our country. We have a role to play as media practitioners, and our role is not to tear our country apart, but to expose ills in society and make sure that the right thing is done for the development of our country. As we alluded to you during the discussions there, there are several bills before the legislature, and there is a political will. The president, there was a meeting in Buchanan, she's now submitted a bill to the legislature to decriminalize free speech so that it can no longer be a criminal offense. That can be civil offense. That bill is with the legislature. The pressure is on the legislature. But our concern is that the Senate is still in session, but the representatives are seeking re-election. So it is our responsibility now to put pressure on them. The civil society groupings are working. And when the president is leaving office, the radio stations and newspapers, as we all discussing, are operating. But we need to ensure that high-level professionalism is exhibited in the media setting. Because if that is not done, the freedom of expression, the free press we talk about, the democracy, we can bring our country into another situation that will hamper development and the peace process. But we trust the ability of those in Liberia, the journalists, despite the economic constraints, that most of them continue to observe ethical standards and do the work required of a journalist. The former presidents will help us a lot because they had a vision for the press. You know, we made that vision, and we intend to foster that vision and continue to advocate for free press, the rights of the people. And if the land they have acquired on behalf of the union is now being developed. But press union will only survive to the highest level with your support because you are situated, you have the expertise. We expect you to help us to bring some of our colleagues abroad. The exposure alone is education, so they can see the facilities, the media entities, the way their colleagues operate, and they are nationally listed for the good of our country. Thank you. We will continue this process. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Mr. Washington, the Honorable Mr. Washington, J. Wesley Washington from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I'm sure he's in the house, right? To make a remark on behalf of the government of Liberia. I mean, he's in part of the basket, but all right. Okay, we'll abolish that. So, that's about remarks. We will have the acknowledgement by the outgoing Secretary General, Mr. Gani V. Woodson. And after that, we'll have Mr. Quincy T. come back and just stir up small time before we officially close the program. I'm meeting on New Joseph.
Where is he, sir?
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to say thank you for coming. It has been a wonderful night. We will like to acknowledge our guest speaker, Mr. Abraham G. Masale, who graciously accepted our invitation to be here and to be our guest speaker. When we release the information to the public that Masale was to be our guest speaker, we said that it was necessitated because he has been one of us and he was president of the PUL at the time when we had our series of civil wars. I said series because at a certain point we stopped and we thought we have achieved peace and another time it started all over again. So I would say series. Having said that, and time being far spent, I would just like to acknowledge all of you for coming, and for the few minutes you're going to be here, I hope you're going to dance to the best of your ability. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll continue with laughter. We want to bring on our co-host for the second time, Mr. Quincy T. Put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen.
This song caused problem already. On a serious note, you want to kill somebody, dog.
Mommy, no, you know, mommy, we're small. Sometimes I tell like, you, I say, we got to try to be not necessarily large in a sense, but.
What that?
I say, many people come here, so, you know, we got to pay our way to
go. Not many.
I said, we gotta be civilized sometimes when you're talking to your woman. You know, you want this woman fire or something. You gotta make it sexy, you gotta make it sweet. But you look at your dream face and say, baby, I want to get your dog. You will get your spirit. My own brother, Gene Yemon, let me tell you something about comedy. Comedy is like when the DJ is playing your favorite song. you always want to hear Dala. I don't care how many times the DJ plays, it's your favorite song. You always want to hear it. That how come it is? So I want to give some of the men a piece, small piece of her. Small piece, just one small one. If you're not married and you hear you want to get married, how can you tell whether that woman, that the woman was sent for you? There's only one thing you can do. Let me tell you that. Invite her to your house on a weekend. Before she come, all the food I can give men gas that he must eat. The display blanket, bath full. Lock it on your bed, every corner of the bed, lock it, leaving a small space for you to go inside. Keep her under that display blanket. In fact, if she pour him outside, don't marry her. If she stay under that blanket, that means she can stay anything that be a wife. That the only way. Once you can stay in that man fact, you can stay anything. But you don't know that. Where you go, she will get say, you say you know that body you carry? And you say she will get say? That what is the virus? They're not virus, man. You don't do that. But that's a good way to test whether the woman loves you or not. You see, a lot of men don't understand women. That is why they're facing problems. You slept on God many people. Scripture did not tell us how long the men slept for, but if you assume we slept for almost 20 years. Between 18 to 20, two clever people can marry. Yeah, my brother Masali asked him. He can be clever, he was clever than a lie. One person gotta be stupid. Hello? You want your marriage to last, brother? Play dummy. You say you want to be clever, you go to the woman, you all wear black soon. When you hear the papa then saying, we celebrating 30 years, 40 years, what are you talking? You think you're able to act? Look, God impact these people with so much. You don't know the ability. A woman is like an incubator. Anything you put inside will double it. Hello? Oh, I'm not lying, oh. Anything you give them, they will double. The only problem I get with them is that, like the, you're sorry if I say, the feminist, when they say, you and the man, you're equal. In America, they say, you're a partner. When God made man, he never mentioned partner. Adam was alone. Adam was not lonely. There's a difference between alone and lonely. But these people, God made us for them and them for us. So most men, they won't on air. We on air? I got to ask some questions. You sure you on air? But when the time is late now, right? So I can throw some more fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can throw some fire. Look, when you and a woman having a nice time, and you enjoy, don't allow her to keep you there long, especially when you know you're supposed to stay long. The men tell you are coming, then you say no, don't come. For wedding, where are you doing? That football match? Baby, I want to come. He said no, don't come here. Wait. For me, I will come. You want to come, you can follow me later on, but I will not go. The people precious. God face them. Then you the men too. You say you want a Chinese Viagra. You want a Chinese dust. You want mix all kind of proportion to do better in that caterpillar. Let me tell you women that the Baba thing they men can be doing. I will expose you. Come on, catch it. Will not be the same. What thing? What thing you will do? What thing you will do? Why should they dancing your coming dance? All the men that are Papa 50 and I warn them, don't dance with any woman and go down to boogie. You might not come back up. When I think lack, that's just you can get here. Then you think the man bluffing, he get number, he can't come up, he get ready. They say, oh baby, give it to me. Give it to who? Your poor ambulance. Seriously. Look, that the sweetest thing God made you don't know. Nothing sweet equal to nothing. Nothing. Sugar second baking. Liberia got some serious, I won't call it discovery, but by nature, powerful places that we didn't know existed. For example, when God put Satan down, you know where he dropped the first era? That in Liberia. Hello? If you challenge me, I can prove it. We can bet on it. If I like, huh? Good, I got witness. God, when God threw the devil down, that Liberia he landed. He landed between Nima and Brinjide. The other day that one answered an angel. That Jogo, before the man Jogo can get back. That Jogo. To see find your man as nothing. The winning always fun. When Satan fell down, then he dropped there. If you see any ugly man, he tell you say a crew. Check it. Are you bad yo or a man? Can I easy? Can I easy? You can't easily fun. Hey, but I like what I'm saying. Yeah, but don't say my man back down there.
He won't like your back.
He won't like your back. You can't make it. Look, when you're 40 years old or above, men, only 3 stand. Don't let any woman fool you. I don't care how she can be heavily in that. Only 3. Lay down your back, turn to the left, or turn to the right. And then I'm going to start the whole way up and go. Hello? Because nowadays now they say, I don't know how they call the thing. How can I tell me now they can get them? Baby, come. Yeah. Come where? Come where? Yeah. If you can't come here, I'm not going there. Because of the thing that bringing most of the trouble today in the world. Look, woman, women, let me tell you. The Bible says, God says, he who finds a wife, he didn't say she will find a man. All you need to do as a woman, position yourself after you find him. Hello? When he find you, he will see quality in you. When you go look for him, he will think that a certain demand you want, certain thing you want, you will want to be controlling and demanding, you will get chopped and give it. I can go money. Because I was watching television here, what's the guy name? Steve Harvey, yes. He said the women, they don't go out to find men. I said, ah! They will go find, they will come back around the show to look at him. And your two, when the man tell you, say, baby, I don't have a job, then you won't get your own no more. But by the time that man, that whole phone, yes, hello? What? No, I told you to, my man, I just gave Nimine $20,000. You'll get this container out of Freeport. By the time Maria get in here, they say, let an investor here. It's good for you to listen what the men are discussing. I was in Grand Royal Hotel. This guy took his friend for lunch. They're sitting, eating, and all of a sudden, the guy said to his friend, he said, my brother, in the next 3 months, I want to capture the entire oil industry in this country. The guy said, what? Oil industry, you let it work, me take one no car. She called the waitress. I'll pay for the bill, okay? Now for investment. When the guy won't pay, the waitress said no, the lady on the table. And the guy was surprised when he moved, he said, hi. You know, this one, I mean, I just saw you, I got attracted and blah, 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 blah. When you know they started dating, she bought a car for the guy. 3 months passed, she gets the investment. Oh, baby, oh. You told me you were coming to take all the, I'm already talking about the oil industry. You're coming to, they can say, we oil, my red oil, I sell it, red oil to red left. The club broke down. You see, when you even want to ask too much questions, you're the women, how you're getting in trouble? The men selling oil, the car coming from Brent, they broke down the road. Look, if you on Facebook and you're chatting with, maybe you're a lady make friend on Facebook, but maybe you haven't spoken or to have some chat and you send greetings, they will not reply. Hello? No reply. How you doing? No reply. You seem busy, eh? No reply. Okay, I'll talk to you later. No reply. It gets secret. Especially in Liberia. Liberia, just send credit card number there, get postal number. Don't correct it. Leave 2-3 number up. Send it. She will call you. There are just some numbers there now that we never. Tell her that you're 33 series number. Something wrong with you? Mommy, the people can suck, they're not easy. I can tell most of the women, I said, look, sometimes you gotta lie to the man that you're okay. Don't let him know, maybe you're catching hard time. Yeah. When he asks you, how are you doing, where you live? You know how you're feeling yourself, how you're working? But some of your friends can spot it. But then you meet again, say, how you doing, man? I like you. Can I have your contact? Oh, my phone is falling in water. Yeah? By the time she told her, one lay, go, they, you coming back, new phone, and an expensive phone. If you ask, where do you live? And she tells you, say, oh, the place where Ellie let us move, but one of my friends, that phone, please, give it. You can be paying rent, though. One guest offered me the other day, here on lunch, a la lagoon, in fact, dinner, a la lagoon. Drive around, buy one or two things. Hey, I can get a case. She said, case, baby. We get meeting. You can wait at least 1 or 2 months. I said 2 months get your case. Then to go to Jerusalem now. That 1 year. She said, yeah, well, you know, I'm going to rush this thing. I'm going to take it easy. Yeah. I said, okay, I hear you. What are you doing on the weekend? I said, oh, I'm supposed to go do some window shopping. Oh, God, I need to come with you. I said, well, you're welcome. We'll go to exclusive. She grabbed the biggest cat. Get buying, get talking things inside. She like it. She can be, you can go to the car, just talk a few things. I said, what are you rushing here for? Hey, you can wait at least 2 months or something. Oh, to case, I'm away for 2 months, but my money will come outside. You won't wait for 2 months. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I see you.
Oh, goodness. Oh, quickly before, no. Just as a courtesy, every profession has to be supported. Yeah. So if you laugh and you want to support Mr. T, the chair will be a small bubble wrap up. You can just bring your list more to him. The man got to pay his way because he's been using his walking GPS. So he won't take testing tonight. So I beg you, all, you know what? Come. Now I'm going to tell you, that fee for service, use this only and just go around the table, huh?
All right.
We gotta pay the man with the man want to come. If you laugh, small thing, just small thing, anything.
Don't call that brand dollar.
Let's pay the man with. I also put the man professional. Don't forget the podium guest though. I wear the big money here. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, while he's doing that, we want to call on the Reverend Dr. Zizekwane for the benediction.
Well, that's how we're going to leave it here this evening. That's the 7th Annual Conventions of ALJA, the first Zian Sort of the Liberia Public Radio. That's Quincy T, just still the place called here. We want to welcome on the first thing to all of our viewers across the globe, across the world, watching this evening. That's the 7th annual dinner board of ALJA. Let's go to Reverend Dr. Zizabade, who is now giving the benediction. Today.
We thank you for ALJA. We thank you for all of the deliberations. We thank you for Liberia. for national patrimony. We thank you for peace. We thank you because you brought us a mighty long way. And even at this crucial hour, as we depart here tonight, Father, may you continue to strengthen us in body, mind, and spirit to continue to do what is expected of us to make that Liberia a great nation. We pray for peace, we pray for love, we pray for healing. Liberia needs healing. Liberia has become a hospital. It needs a doctor. And indeed, come October the 10th, may you by proclamation, working through the hearts of millions of Liberians, bring us a faithful leader, a leader that has love for the nation and its people. The cry has been too long. Bring us delivery. We thank you as we depart these wars tonight. May you take us home safely to our respective destinations, O Lord. And even as we meet tomorrow at service and for our final gathering, may you continue to strengthen us to love, to care, to cherish one another, to stop tearing one another apart, but keep building up to make the nation what it needs to be. Bring peace and hope to the brokenhearted and strengthen the visionaries who are here tonight and in Liberia and in all parts of the world that have association with the country called Liberia to return to the New Jerusalem. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen,
I want to thank all of you for coming tonight and supporting us
for the world. The end of Argentina, BANQUET, the ball is about to start.
All of the organizers, the Delaware
associations of Liberian journalists here based here at Argentina BANQUET.
Thank you to our guests.
Ongoing here at Newcastle, Delaware, President Ibrahim Ansale,
and all of the institutions here at
I want to thank our platform guests,
our guest speaker,
the wives of
our leaders who made
the MC here at
program
a
success to the whole,
the comedians and veteran
broadcaster, to the LPR, like Broadcasting Radio,
and everyone,
so it's time
it's to time dance.
Dinner
put on your dancing shoes and let's have fun. Thank you.
To come out tomorrow, there will be the 7. DJ Tobak is right here. It's time to have everybody come. We want to thank you so much for being here. We have the most of the answer with the Liberian Public Radio crew. It's time to have dance.
Thank you very much.
march.